right, the first, in that order. That's how we break the news. We don't just narrate events as they unfold. We gather insights from all sides to help you see through the spin. That is ANC's Rundown, Monday to Friday at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. and Saturday at 8 a.m. here on ANC.
In this episode, we take a long and close look at two of the most sought after and talked about sports cars and sports watches and see if they're worth the high price and the long wait. We'll test drive the new Taycan, Porsche's first ever all-electric supercar, and examine how Patek Philippe's recently discontinued Nautilus model is driving a global frenzy and surge in prices.
This is the Philippines. We are ANC.
Michelle Long. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines for today: the International Monetary Fund raises its 2021 growth forecast for the Philippines to 6.9% from an earlier estimate of 6.6% growth, but says it is critical to contain the virus surge. The IMF also lifting its global growth forecast to 6%, but warns of a diverging rebound. China set to lead the pack post-pandemic. Wall Street falls in its lowest trading day of 2021 as another record-breaking rally took a pause. Asian shares, though, set to continue their climb. Here at home, the PSE index climbs back to the 6,500 level as investors digested the lower-than-expected inflation print for March. Jovis Vistan of AB Capital Securities joins us for a market outlook. And the Philippines reports 382 new COVID-19 deaths, the highest since the pandemic began. A brighter economic outlook for the Philippines as the International Monetary Fund raises its growth forecast for the country despite the virus surge and the extended lockdowns. It now sees the Philippine economy growing 6.9% this year, the fastest in the ASEAN region, and it's also an upward revision from its previous forecast of 6.6% growth. For 2022, the IMF retained its 6.5% growth projection for the country. But the multilateral lender warns the outlook for the Philippines is subject to uncertainty brought by the rising number of COVID-19 cases in the past weeks. Now, that spike has led to the reimposition of the strictest lockdown in the capital, Metro Manila, and nearby provinces for another 2 weeks, which the National Economic and Development Authority has said could shave off nearly 1% from the country's 2021 GDP. Philippine economic managers expecting a GDP growth of 6.5 to 7.5% this year and 8 to 10% in 2022. But that's coming off from a 9.5% contraction last year, the worst since the Second World War. The IMF also upgrading its global growth outlook for this year, thanks largely to unprecedented policy responses to the pandemic. It now expects the global economy to grow 6% for 2021. That's up from its January forecast of 5.5% growth. Looking ahead, IMF predicts a 4.4% growth next year. The IMF's 2021 forecast, if realized, would mark the fastest pace of global growth since 1976. But it also comes off the steepest annual drop of the post-war era, as the pandemic brought the global economy to a near standstill last year, leading to a 3.3% contraction. The IMF also warning improvements on the outlook could easily be tipped off by the pandemic.
What we are seeing is multi-speed recoveries around the world. What that means is that countries are at very different stages, both in terms of the pandemic, but also in terms of their recovery and how quickly they're coming back to pre-COVID GDP levels. So that's why we emphasize that now it's important for countries to take a tailored approach which is specific to where they are in terms of the speed of their recovery and in terms of a country's specific characteristics.
As for the U.S., it says it decided to go big with its COVID-19 response to avert the long-lasting impact of the pandemic. The IMF earlier credited its revised global growth outlook to the improving economic situation in the U.S. following the rollout of its massive $1.9 trillion stimulus. But for Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen, while the rapid recovery in the U.S. would boost overall global growth, more work needs to be done to shore up weakness exposed by the pandemic.
We are going to be careful to learn the lessons of the financial crisis, which is don't withdraw support too quickly. And we would encourage all those developed countries that have the capacity using fiscal policy and monetary policy to continue to support a global recovery for the sake of the growth in the entire global economy.
On to the financial markets. Wall Street falling from record highs overnight as the rally driven by signs of a strong U.S. economic rebound took a bit of a breather. Volume on U.S. exchanges also slipping below 10 billion shares for the first time this year. The Dow Jones slipping nearly 100 points, ending the session down by about 0.3%. The S&P 500 meanwhile falling to 40.73, snapping a three-day winning streak dragged by tech and healthcare shares, but thankfully offset by some gains from retailers. Meantime, the tech-heavy NASDAQ also inching lower. And going back to stocks tied to the Archegos scandal, they managed to end the session higher as well, as investors seem to be brushing off news that Credit Suisse unloaded more than $2 billion of shares in its latest block trade. Now, looking at the broader stock market decline, this actually came even after more strong news on the labor front. U.S. job openings rose 268,000 in January, which came on the heels of Friday's strong payrolls report, and a report on Monday showing activity in the service sector climbing to a record high in March. The IMF also raising its U.S. 2021 growth outlook to 6.4% from an earlier projection of 5.1%. But with the upcoming earnings season, investors may be waiting to see just how strong the results will actually be.
The stock market has done a pretty good job of figuring out this trajectory of economic growth coming out of this very large depression. And so we've already seen these massive rallies off the lows and even strong performance this year. And the market's figured out two things. The first, earnings growth is going to be fantastic this year because not only do we have good economic growth, but we have a lot of operating leverage inside of companies. So we're looking for on the order of $200 a share of earnings out of the S&P by the end of Q3 and Q4. As a run rate going into 2021. The second thing the market's figured out is interest rates are going to stay low because as much liquidity as we're pumping into the system, we're not going to get the kind of sustainable inflation that would make rates go to 2.5% or 3%. And that's very good for equity valuations.
Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, looks like all the major indices are set for a rebound when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Now, moving over here in Asia, stocks are edging higher at the open, even after Wall Street pulled back from record highs overnight. As you can see, Australia's ASX 200 is up by nearly 0.5% in early trade, while shares in Japan and South Korea also firmly in the green. That's after the IMF boosted its global growth forecast. Investors clearly cheering that news. In other news, U.S. President Joe Biden says he has not spoken to Federal Reserve Chair Jerome Powell since taking office more than 2 months ago. The reason, he says, he respects the independence of the central bank, marking a sharp turn from the previous administration. Former U.S. President Donald Trump repeatedly clashed with Powell, threatening to fire him multiple times for not keeping interest rates low. The Fed eventually lowered rates near 0%. But it has kept them as the U.S. economy weathered the COVID-19 pandemic.
Look, I think the Federal Reserve is an independent operation. And starting off my presidency, I want to be real clear that I'm not going to do the kinds of things that have been done in the last administration. either talking to the Attorney General about who he's going to prosecute or not prosecute and under what circumstances, or the Fed telling them what they should and shouldn't do, even though that wouldn't be the basis upon which I'd be talking to them. So I've been very fastidious about not talking to them, but I do talk to the Secretary of Treasury.
Powell's four-year term ends in February 2022. Biden can choose to reappoint him or nominate someone else later this year. Now, here's some economic data we're monitoring today. Wednesday, the Reserve Bank of India will announce its latest policy decision. The central bank is expected to maintain its accommodative monetary stance to support India's economy amid the return of partial mobility curbs to contain the spread of the virus. The US, Canada, and Greece will also be releasing their February trade figures, and we're going to get a look at how Italy's services sector performed in March. Italy's IHS Markit Italy Services PMI rose to 48.8 in February, the seventh straight monthly drop in activity, although the rate of decline was at its lowest since last September. Now, this morning, we're going to speak with one of the world's biggest and most recognizable direct selling companies about retail 2.0. How will retail look like post-pandemic? How is it doing today? Avon Philippines General Manager Razvan Duration joins us live from Makati City. Hi, Raz. Good morning.
Hello, Michelle. Good morning, and good morning, everyone.
Okay, great to finally have you on the show. Roz, I want to start with this, because last year in September, we actually spoke to Avon World CEO Angela Cretu, and I remember her saying that Avon will turn a profit in 2020, because despite the slump in the first few months of the pandemic, sales in non-essentials like beauty and apparel have actually picked up. Is that the case for the Philippine market? And if so, what's flying off the shelves these days? Is it still lipstick or lingerie?
Absolutely, absolutely, Michelle. And that's perfectly true. So actually, last year was a very interesting year for our business. And I think at this moment, after a year when it was terrible and very complicated for all of us, I can say that for Avon Philippines, we're exactly there where we expected on this. It was a year with ups and downs. I mean, I'm extremely proud to say that we kept all our people, we kept all the jobs, and all our representatives there are with us. But it was also a year with a lot of learnings because the demand changed significantly. And here I'm coming to your point. So, as you know, Avon in Philippines, it's particularly well known for beauty products. I mean, color category, fragrances. These are products that at this moment, they are not so high in the demand of the consumers, and it's obvious why. But new categories are coming and are taking the lead. For example, essentials, we all know around that. So they are flying at this moment. But very, very interesting and somehow a surprise at a certain moment, it's intimate apparel, which it is actually a category that was growing for us, particularly in quarter four last year. So this is also showing how important is this channel and how direct selling can be an alternative for the traditional retail. Once you have in this direct selling also the digital component, because actually this was the game changer to improve and to transform our business.
Mm-hmm. Raz, could you very quickly give us an idea how sales did last year? Would you say you got flat sales? Sales were down slightly. By how much, or were you able to see sales pick up?
Yeah, I mean, overall sales last year for us, they were in line with the market. I mean, from our data at this moment, the market was decreasing. We're still looking at this moment to get the final data for last year, so the reports are not issued. But what is very important for us is that we kept the market share position, and as far we know at this moment with our preliminary data, We are still number one in a couple of categories like color for lotions, fragrance, and particularly for intimate apparel. We are very curious to see exactly the final numbers in the weeks to come.
Okay. Roz, what would you say would your main priorities for Avon Philippines be this year for 2021? Everyone's hoping it's going to be a recovery year.
Absolutely. And the priorities, they're always the same. And I think this is important, how a company is keeping the strategy and the purpose even during pandemic. So the first important priority is to drive our purpose. So to secure a better world for all women in Philippines, but also around the world. So particularly for Philippines, we are looking how to support women to have a financial independence, also to fight against domestic violence. This is a very, very serious issue, which is increased during the lockdown when people, they were staying locked in their homes. And especially also breast cancer, which it is a disease which is increasing. And at this moment, you should be even more careful because people should go to control, medical control, even during pandemic, because otherwise it might be too late. So this is from the purpose point of view. And of course, we want to secure health and safety for everyone. That's the most important thing. All the other business thing which I will bring here, I mean, one very important priority which are continuing at this moment is the digital platform that we are building. And actually in just a couple of weeks, you'll see a very spectacular launch for all our representatives. It will be a totally new platform together with our already developed apps that we are having for their business. So we are having an Avon On and an Avon Grow app, which at this moment they are helping them to drive their business. And last but not least, really invest in securing better service level and better quality products adapted for the Philippine market and adapted to the new trends of the consumer, which at this moment we are working for our future launches. So stay tuned.
Very exciting times ahead. We're looking forward to the apps, the digital platforms, certainly the way to go into the future. I wanted to focus on one thing that you said earlier, that you continue to empower women through financial ways. Avon for years has been giving women, you know, a more convenient, flexible way of making money. Could you give us a sense how many more signups you're getting during the pandemic? How much has your network of women sales representatives, Avon ladies, has grown over the past 12 months?
So, this is one very important part of our purpose. And actually, we noticed that direct selling, it is an alternative for all the issues that there are actually in this economic situation with a lot of people that unfortunately they are losing their jobs. So more and more people at this moment, they are joining our network because making direct selling business with Avon, it's quite easy. So you can start your own business without any investment. So you are getting the products on credit for more than 30 days. And this is actually helping because people, they can start run and securing their earnings. At this moment, what we are noticing is that the number of recruits, actually it's increasing campaign by campaign, I would say double digit versus previous year. And even in some of the months, we are significantly better than the numbers before pandemic. Ooh. And another thing which we are noticing and we are trying to have a response for this is that more and more people, they are coming through digital channels. So there are people that are eager from their homes, of course, being still in lockdown, particularly in ECQ for Manila, as you know, but people, they want to run their business from their home. And this one is possible with Avon because you can recruit online, we can deliver the products even to your customer without going out from your home. So I think it's a good alternative for the situation where we are.
Just give us an idea, Roz, how big is your network of Avon ladies here in the Philippines? Are we talking about a million Filipinas part of your network at least?
So yeah, it's a big, it's a very big number. We are not talking about really 1 million, but it is a significant number of Filipinas all around the country. By the way, because we are serving all the regions, and as you know, we are having at this moment more than 190 branches around the country.
Mm-hmm. Okay. In Brazil, for example, where your parent company Natura is based, Avon has started to use a FICO platform to improve the credit granting program or initiative of the company. In fact, that FICO platform supposedly cut representatives' bad debt indicators by 72%. Avon Brazil has also automated 90% of limit increase requests made by the sales reps. First of all, I guess I'm curious, if you have a lot of Avon ladies here in the Philippines, what is the level of bad debt among your Filipino representatives? And are there plans to use a credit scoring system here?
That's true. And thank you for bringing this initiative that our colleagues in Brazil, they did. It's mm-hmm. actually a very important initiative. And payment system at this moment, as you know, it's very important part, because we are moving also in this area from the traditional bank payment through different types of alternatives. For example, what we just launched, and this is 2 weeks ago, it's a platform for e-payment. So actually, on this platform, very soon you'll be able to pay with credit card, debit card, but also having a combination of all alternatives of payment in Philippines in one unique point, where actually people, they can use it and to make alternative payments rather than going only cash to bank. Secondly, coming to your question regarding bad debt is not so high. And I think here it's also very, very important how our people in our branches, they are doing the screening, the scoring for the people. We are counting here because most of our recruitments are coming as a recommendation from our sales leaders. So we are keeping the maturity actually with the people that they are good payers, and they are not so much impacted as and this. Of course, during the pandemic, this increased for a short period of time, and this is absolutely understandable considering that people lost their jobs. But after that, they recovered and they gained income. So I think it's a healthy business and market in Philippines. Mm-hmm.
Great to hear. Roz, let's look at the big picture. I mean, from global direct selling to social selling, Avon has evolved. I remember many years ago, it was the Avon ladies ding dong, and now it's becoming click, click. Essentially, you're high touch and high tech. I also know you've got over 6 million consultants and representatives all over the world. But for all intents and purposes, I think Avon still considers itself a multi-level marketing company, alongside other brands like Tupperware or Amway or Infinitos. What's the outlook for this industry, especially now, I guess, where it's more in-home than in-store for those who are in lockdown?
So we are, first of all, we call ourselves, and we like more to say that we are relationship business.
Relationship business.
Channels how to sell, they are different from market, and also from period to period. And really doesn't matter if it is traditional in the store, if it is on the online. So these are actually just alternative. We are a relationship mm-hmm. business because the most important thing for us is the people and the purpose. And I think beside all the commercials, it's actually the connection that we can build through beauty, between women, but not only the entire community. And always, either when it was ding dong or when it was click click, it was a joy to receive an Avon product. And I think this will never be changed, whatever pandemic or whatever digital channel will have. And also, of course, we'll hope that in the future, when the pandemic will end, we'll still be able to be together and to bring those beautiful events face to face.
Final question. Clearly, it's a digital shift that's happening. While the internet has opened a whole new world of consumers, it has also opened a whole new world of brands. Is Avon finding it hard to compete these days with more new names sprouting up and micro-influencers promoting, you know, a more diversified lineup?
I mean, of course, competition is increasing. And from my point of view, this is very good for the consumers because they're having multiple choices. But it's also very good for us and for any company because it's an opportunity to improve and you need to compete and you need to be actually exactly where the consumer wants to be. Yes, there are multiple brands that are coming. I think the differentiation here is coming from the purpose first. And that's why I think this is something that you should never compromise as a business. Second is coming from the quality of products, and Avon here it is in a very good position, considering all our studies and research and development centers that we are having. I mean, just as an example, mm-hmm. we launched a protein line on the skincare, which is improving 7 years of lost collagen in just 7 days. So that's an amazing innovation. And third, which I think it's making a big difference in the market, is the level of service. People doesn't want at this mm-hmm. moment only products, but they want an experience and a very good service, the way the product is coming at their home with all the explanation and also training and support for how to use that that product. So these are the things that we are focusing as well.
Roz, final question. Speaking of brands, I know that Avon last year was bought by the Brazilian firm Natura. So you've got sister brands now, The Body Shop, which is here, Aesop and Natura. Are there plans to bring Aesop and Natura, these brands, to the Filipino consumers?
Aesop, as far as I know, they're having one store.
They're already here. Okay.
In Philippines. At this moment, yes, there are plans that they are working on this one, particularly how to expand our presence in Asia. Mm-hmm. For Philippines, Avon is by far the market leader on this one, and one of the very important market in Avon portfolio and also in Natura portfolio for mm-hmm. it's by far the biggest market for Asia. So at this moment, really the plans of the group are to focus on how to grow Avon and to develop even further for this beautiful market, which is Philippines.
I know that we've been called the crown jewel of your markets. Thank you so much, Roz, for joining us this morning. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Michelle, for the invitation. Stay safe and see you soon.
Stay safe.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Up next, can Philippine shares extend the rally to a third straight day? Jovis Vistan of AB Capital Securities joins us for some perspective when Market Edge returns.
Does your anti-dandruff shampoo make your hair dry? Dove Dermacare Scalp is different. We treat one leaf with Dove. With time, one leaf becomes dry, while the leaf with Dove stays flake-free and nourished. 100% dandruff-free, 100% care, zero compromise. Dove Dermacare Scalp.
Tingnan nyo, oh! Puti ito!
Mas puti ito!
Mas puti ito! Mas puti ito! Oh.
mas puting ito.
Sa Pride Bar, pwedeng hindi na mag-bleach, tina o anyel. Dahil ang Pride Bar ay may power whitener na nanunood sa bawat hibla. Kaya ang gamit ay kislap puti at banayad pa sa kamay.
Mas puti ito, mas puti ito, mas puti ito.
Pride Bar, hindi lang puti, kislap puti.
PCS. Araw-araw sa eskwela, nagkakasubukan ng galing. Gano'ng kagaling ang bad soup mo?
Ah! Uy, araw!
Agwi pawis!
Ang bango mo pa rin. Shield Bath Soap. May 24-hour germ protection. May shea butter pa, tulong para hindi mag-dry ang skin. At may malasakit sa budget. Kaya recommended ng Philippine Nurses Association. I challenge you. Subukan mong Shield. Shield. Galit sa sakit, may malasakit.
ACS. Does your anti-dandruff shampoo make your hair dry? Dove Dermacare Scalp is different. We treat one leaf with Dove. With time, one leaf becomes dry, while the leaf with Dove stays flake-free and nourished. 100% dandruff-free, 100% care, zero compromise. Dove Dermacare Scalp.
Salamat sa over-over na support, mga baby!
Favorite scene ko dun sa movie is nagkita ulit sila Angel sa Kalayan after how many years?
Ang ganda talaga ng pagkaka-act nila. Nakikita mo talaga na sila talaga yung nag-work bilang OFW.
This movie truly captures the heartache that a lot of our kababayans have to go through in the name of responsibility.
Bilang to simple rom-com, malalim yung kwento.
Love or Money, now on its fourth week!
I am Ernie Lopez.
And I am Wowie Wong. Together, we travel the Philippines to discover the secrets behind its amazing wrecks.
Let's wreck and roll! Boom!
You're transported to this different world wherein rebels, they don't exist here. But what exists here is this coexistence of nature and man.
Congratulations dahil kayo ang mga bibida sa pinakabagong Pinoy adventure show na Biyaheng South Korea! Yeah!
Does your anti-dandruff shampoo make your hair dry? Dove Dermacare Scalp is different. We treat one leaf with Dove. With time, one leaf becomes dry, while the leaf with Dove stays flake-free and nourished. 100% dandruff-free, 100% care, zero compromise. Dove Dermacare Scalp.
Tingnan nyo oh, puti ito! Mas puti ito!
Mas puti ito! Mas puti ito! Mas puti ito!
Sa Pride Bar, pwedeng hindi na mag-bleach, tina o anyel. Dahil ang Pride Bar ay may power whitener na nanunood sa bawat hibla. Kaya ang gamit ay kislap puti at banayad pa sa kamay.
Mas puti ito! Mas puti ito! Mas puti ito!
Pride Bar, hindi lang puti, kislap puti!
PCS. Araw-araw sa eskwela, nagkakasubukan ng galing. Gano'ng kagaling ang bad soup mo?
Agwi pawis!
Ang bango mo pa rin. Shield Bath Soap. May 24-hour germ protection. May shea butter pa, tulong para hindi mag-dry ang skin. At may malasakit sa budget. Kaya recommended ng Philippine Nurses Association. I challenge you. Subukan mong Shield. Shield. Galit sa sakit, may malasakit.
ACS! Salamat sa over-over na support, mga baby!
Favorite scene ko dun sa movie is nagkita ulit sila Angel sa Kalayan after how many years?
Ang ganda talaga ng pagkaka-act nila. Nakikita mo talaga na sila talaga yung nag-work bilang OFW.
This movie truly captures the heartache that a lot of our kababayans have to go through in the name of responsibility.
Bilang to simple rom-com, malalim yung kwento.
Love or Money, now on its fourth week.
We're still watching Market Edge. The headlines: the International Monetary Fund raises its 2021 growth forecast for the Philippines to 6.9% from an earlier estimate of a 6.6% growth, but says it is critical to contain the virus surge. The IMF also lifting its global growth forecast to 6%, but warns of a diverging rebound. China now set to lead the pack post-pandemic. Wall Street falls overnight in its slowest trading day of the year as another record-breaking rally took a pause. Asian shares, though, continued to climb. Here at home, the PSE index climbs back to the 6,500 level as investors digested the lower-than-expected inflation print for March. Jovis Vistan of AB Capital Securities joins us for a market outlook. And the Philippines reports 382 new COVID-19 deaths, the highest since the pandemic began. The Philippine Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 6590, up for two straight days already, but now they're falling. We're about 4 minutes into trade and the index is now down 0.1%. Make that 0.2%, widening those losses. We're off about 11 points, 6579. Joining us now for his take on the markets, Jovis Vistan of AB Capital Securities. Hi, Jovis. Good morning.
Morning, Mimi.
Okay, so Jovis, we've been going up the past 2 days, despite the extended restrictions. We're down today, but really just marginally lower. No panic selling, surprisingly. Why do you think so? Are investors now more constructive, or does this market still feel dangerously clinging on to life, ready to drop at the slightest hint of bad news?
Well, I think for starters, Mimi, the market is technically oversold. We started the year near the highs because we ended 2020 quite strong. So we've been down since the start of the year, and we've reached a certain level that from a technical standpoint, we're already oversold. Mm-hmm. Fundamentally, we're already at around median, 5-year median valuations. So at that point, there are certainly some issues that would be bargain hunting worthwhile. No? So I think there are some accumulation of certain cheap issues, and at the same time, technically, we're oversold. Another thing, Mimi, I think is that I think you're referring to the expected panic selling brought about by the rising COVID cases. I think we can consider this thing as a thing that is not a black swan event. This is something that as early as last year, no? When we sort of flattened the curve, everybody were thinking that there would be a second wave of rising COVID cases. And I think this is the one. So in a way, the market is oversold. This is something that is not surprising, and that the government has been taking actions to address this problem. That is why there's no panic selling.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned some bargain hunting might be worthwhile. Would this be bargain hunting for blue chips or for speculative names?
Definitely more on blue chips, Mimi. Mm. I'm referring more on the blue chip issues, yes.
Okay, but when you look at the market oversold levels, this isn't exactly a black swan event anymore. The volume's drying up. I remember at the start of the year, we were doing upwards of 15 billion pesos a day, and now we're down to 5, 6 billion. That's nearly just a third of what we saw in the start of the year. Where is the money going? Why is the volume drying up?
I think, Mimi, because you're looking at the January and February volume, which was really driven by a lot of speculative trading on issues like second, third liners. Most of that 15 billion volume that you were mentioning were concentrated on a select second, third liners only. It was really not on the more fundamentally sound investment type of volume. It was really more of momentum trading, swing trading, and day trading. So in a way, that the appetite for such type of trades and risk have tapered off a little, which is why right now from trading, it's really more of accumulating quality blue chip issues right now.
Okay, so speaking of the speculative names that really drove momentum traded volumes, could you be referring to one company that's a loss-making mining firm that's recently been suspended by the PSE?
Yes, that's
something like that.
Yes.
Okay. Jovis, looking at the bigger picture, fundamentally speaking, it seems like we're in for, you know, a fits and starts type of recovery across emerging markets. And it's really not just the Philippines. If you look at India, they're locking down again because of a new wave of COVID. How do you make money in a market like this then? And I wanted to cite this. Yesterday, Secretary Sonny Dominguez of the Finance Department gave a Bloomberg interview, and he said that first, first quarter growth GDP is going to be lower than expected because of the surge, but the death rate here is much lower at just 12 per 100,000 people versus 150 in the West. He says the lockdown is going to cost us 0.5% growth. He says there's no concerns yet of ballooning debt. We have a cap of 60% of GDP for the debt. So far, we've gone up from 39.5 to 54. We're still not hitting the 60% cap, but we've got ample foreign reserves. When you look at the fundamentals from this perspective, what strategy looks good?
Well, right now, I think the strategy for the government is really to focus on what's important and urgent. And that is to address the resurgence of these COVID cases. If it means incurring more debt, as long as we keep the cap in mind, I think that should be okay. But we cannot ignore this pandemic issue, which is going to affect more than just economic indicators, but really more on the investor and consumer confidence side. So I think the strategy of the government is correct. No? Right now, doing the lockdown and hopefully, again, do what we were able to achieve last year, which is to flatten the curve.
Jovis, just wanted to share the PSEI has now swung to positive territory. We're actually flat, slightly up by less than a tenth of 1%. We're at 65.91. Also, I wanted to get your take or your thoughts on this. Secretary Sunny Dominguez also saying that so far there are no plans to introduce new tax measures, but he says they're thinking of winding down some of the debt next year and look at potential revenue sources. He says his team is working on it now. Potential revenue sources. This sounds like new taxes to me. Should investors and businesses worry?
Well, I don't think the government would be prioritizing any contractionary fiscal policy. If they will, I think once the economy has recovered somewhat. I would imagine that they would probably take advantage of the low interest rate environment that we have and probably refinance debt with low interest rates and probably go longer term. But to tax the economy more would be in contrary to what they recently did, no? which is to sign the CREATE bill, which basically lowers corporate income tax. Eventually, I think tax revenues would increase with the economic recovery. That would come.
Okay. That sounds fair. Jovis, let's go over some interesting corporate stories that we have from this morning. Axelum, a manufacturer of coconut products, says it's eyeing a bigger chunk of the U.S. e-commerce market. In fact, they're saying that online sales in the U.S. were up 91% last year. Axelum is one of the relatively new members of the exchange. Are you liking this stock? Are you liking their prospects?
Yes, I've been constantly communicating with them and being updated in terms of their developments. And I think the coconut products have been selling very well on Amazon in the e-commerce segment. It's been consistently in the top 20 list. No? And I think they're expanding the e-commerce segment of their business.
Yes.
And they've been hiring more on the marketing side. And I think they really focus more on the export side and going retail, like digital.
Okay, so you're liking the stock. How about this one? BHI, or Boulevard Holdings, saying that Friday's Puerto Galera Resort is going to be reopening next week. That's after April 11. They're spending $3 to $5 million to be able to prepare for that reopening. Unfortunately, Friday's Boracay Resort will stay closed. They're going to wait until international flights normalize before opening that one. When you look at resorts, what's your take on resorts? I mean, how soon before this segment bounces back?
Take a while, Nini. I don't think it's something that we should really be optimistic about. But at least they've already addressed some of the concerns there in terms of the flooding, etc. The reopening is good news, but don't set your optimism too high right now because of the bigger picture in terms of tourism and leisure is not yet that very positive with the pandemic still in place.
But you know, we've recently heard of developments in the resort space, like the Chu family looking to sell some portions, or in talks at least, with groups like Manny Pangilinan to sell some portions of the Discovery Resort Group.
Yeah.
There seems to be a lot of interest in resorts these days, despite the challenge in travel and tourism.
I think these are investments that are anticipating that eventually in the future, this would definitely benefit from the reopening of the economy. But as I said, it will take a while.
Okay, let's go to a foreign story, a big one. I know you've been covering this as well. We finally have a number. It's $4.7 billion. That's the hit that Credit Suisse is taking from the Archegos hedge fund scandal, from exposed positions, forced liquidations, essentially swaps. We don't have swaps. We don't have this type of instrument yet in the Philippines. Do you think it's time to explore or at least test the waters on derivatives here in the country?
Well, I think the level of financial literacy of Filipinos have improved. We've been growing in that segment. But actually, Mimi, if you look at the Philippines, there are some options and future transactions that are in place, like for airlines and agriculture. So I think the Philippines is really ready for such sophistication.
Wow.
And I think you have to approach the derivatives business as something that is a hedge for risk for people who are really more knowledgeable in valuation of underlying assets. So I think eventually we should be able to diversify into that segment.
But first, before we go to derivatives, we're going to have to approve a short selling. We've been waiting for short selling to finally be allowed for about a year and a half already. So exciting times for Filipino investors. We've now come to the most exciting part of this conversation, your blind item. Talk to us about a stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. I know this stock is different, Jovis. In fact, this is the first time we're having anyone present this stock as their stock pick. So what do you have for us this morning and why do you like it?
Oh my, Mimi. Anyway, I'm putting on my trading hat right now.
This is okay.
That recently saw a surge in volume. It has corrected to a certain level, which I think would have a confluence of support. Those supports are the 61% Fibonacci retracement and the 50-day exponential moving average. So normally, if you have a confluence of support, there would be a technical bounce already.
Ooh.
It's an up-and-coming company, not necessarily fundamentally sound, but it's promising. It's into five segments now. It's into infra, biotech, it's going into fintech, agriculture, and utilities. These are promising sectors, future-ready. But we have yet to see revenues, no? But talking to the company, I think by the middle of this year, we should start seeing revenues being reported. So that's it.
Okay, just one quick question. What sort of upside are you expecting from this stock?
Well, technically, I think you can make 10% or more, probably up to 4 peso level.
Okay, 10% or more.
It's a speculative trading issue. That's a fundamental. So in the next 6 months, let's see. It would be more of a fundamental play.
Okay, we're just going to have to see. Thank you very much, Jovis, for joining us this morning. Always a pleasure speaking with you, sir.
Same to you, Mimi.
Stay safe.
Stay safe. Bye.
Some local governments in the so-called NCR Plus area have begun distributing monetary aid and food aid to residents most affected by the strict lockdown. The Manila City government has already rolled out cash to at least 10,000 residents as of this morning, while more cities are expected to start their payouts today. All in all, close to 23 million low-income families in areas under enhanced community quarantine are expected to receive assistance this week.
the local government units have 15 days upon receipt of the notice of cash allocation to distribute if this will be in cash, and within 30 days to distribute if in kind. Yeah. So we expect the local government units to follow this.
The Philippine government admits it may not achieve its goal of vaccinating 70 million Filipinos against COVID-19 this year. As Vivian Gulia tells us, the country's coronavirus vaccine chief is blaming global supply issues. Take a look.
This advisory is posted at the entrance of a COVID-19 vaccination center in San Pedro, Laguna. Their only remaining vaccine on hand is Sinovac. That's why they can only accommodate health workers and residents with comorbidity aged 18 to 59 years old. But those with comorbidity need to bring proof, a medical certificate or a prescription for medicines issued within the last 18 months. Jun De Grato planned to get fresh prescription from his doctor Wednesday, but he received a text message saying he is scheduled for vaccination Tuesday.
Kailangan po natin ng patunayan na kayo ay may comorbidity sa pamamagitan ng pagpapakita ninyo ng either prescription pad ninyo or medical clearance.
Nag-text po kagabi. Eh, ang schedule naman ni Doc, MWF, kung medical certificate, pwede ba ako magpa-reschedule?
Pwede, tapos balik kayo bukas.
Incidents like this pave the way for the vaccination of eligible residents who walked in.
Nakikita namin na marami na talagang sakit na kumakalat, laganap na. Kaya natatakot din kami, kaya nagpasigil na kami ng vaccine.
The local government of San Pedro, Laguna has vaccinated 1,600 residents so far. Philippine Vaccine Czar Secretary Carlito Galvez Jr. expects additional AstraZeneca doses from the COVAX facility to arrive in the Philippines by the end of April. But the World Health Organization earlier said the next delivery may be less than the initially agreed, close to a million doses due to global supply issues. Galvez also expects the arrival on April 12th of 500,000 doses of Sputnik V produced by Gamaleya in Russia and another 1.5 million doses of Sinovac. Next month, over 4 million doses of COVID vaccine by Sinovac, Gamaleya, and Moderna are seen to be delivered. These numbers are just around half of what was initially expected. Because of this, Galvez sees a delay in the completion of the target to vaccinate 70 million Filipinos this year in order to achieve herd immunity.
With the slippage of the production, most probably, baka bumaba tayo na mga 50%.
With limited COVID vaccine supply, the National Task Force wants to focus on achieving herd immunity, at least in regions with high COVID cases, including Metro Manila. To be able to vaccinate more residents, the National Task Force recommends to the Interim National Immunization Technical Advisory Group to begin next month the COVID vaccination of those who belong to Priority Group A4, which includes economic frontliners, and A5, which covers the indigenous population.
Mas maganda yung sa focus areas tayo. Kasi kung just in case na magkaroon tayo ng slippage, kailangan yung mga mostly affected areas at saka yung tinatawag natin mga economic centers at saka mga vulnerable areas ang talagang tirahin natin.
More than 800,000 Filipinos have been vaccinated against COVID in over a month. This figure is around 1% of the target 70 million Filipinos. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
A travesty, that's how the World Health Organization describes the situation in countries that cannot begin COVID-19 inoculations due to a lack of access to vaccines. For instance, in Namibia, the president decries what he calls vaccine apartheid, where some nations are forced to wait while others obtain shots. Namibia has received jabs from India and China, but it is still waiting for other vaccines, despite having paid a deposit for them.
Scaling up production and equitable distribution remains the major barrier to ending the acute stage of this pandemic. The effort to achieve vaccine equity will not stop this week. WHO will continue to call on governments to share vaccine doses and fill the $22.1 billion gap in the ACT Accelerator for the equitable distribution of vaccines, rapid tests, and therapeutics.
The WHO's COVAX facility has delivered 36 million doses to 86 countries over the past 6 weeks, including the Philippines. Time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. The Bureau of Internal Revenue will not extend the April 15 deadline for the filing and payment of annual income tax returns. But the BIR will allow the filing of a tentative ITR before the deadline as relief for taxpayers and give them until May 15 to amend the returns without penalties. From Business Mirror, with no additional funding coming from the national government, the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration, or OWA, may soon tap its trust fund to continue providing quarantine accommodations for overseas Filipino workers. And from the Wall Street Journal, the UK launches a new regulatory body aimed at policing allegations of anti-competitive behavior among the world's largest technology companies. Britain's new digital markets unit will be tasked with making sure tech giants like Facebook and Google don't exploit any market dominance to crowd out competition. Former Senate President and real estate mogul Manny Villar is still the richest person here in the Philippines. Based on the 35th annual ranking of the world's richest people by Forbes, Villar has a net worth of $7.2 billion in 2021. Worldwide, he ranks 352nd, more than 200 spots higher from his 565th place last year. Now, ports magnate Enrique Razon Jr. comes in number two with an estimated net worth of $5 billion. Tycoon Lu Shotan ranking third, followed by the C siblings and fast food taipan Andrew Tan. Meanwhile, Amazon founder Jeff Bezos is still the richest man in the world with a net worth of $177 billion. He's followed by Tesla's Elon Musk with $151 billion. Rounding out the top five are Bernard Arnault of LVMH or Louis Vuitton, Microsoft's Bill Gates, and Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg. And before we go, another quick look. The index widening gains now firmly in the green. The index up by a fifth of 1%, 14 points. We're at 66.03. And for those who tried to guess the blind item, this is the stock pick of Jovis Bistan. He says this stock saw a recent surge in volumes, has since corrected, seeing a confluence of support, including a 61% Fibonacci replacement and a 50-day moving average, which signals a technical bounce. It is not necessarily a fundamentally sound company, but it is promising. It is future ready. It's speculative for now, but seeing where it's involved in infrastructure, biotech, fintech, agriculture, and utilities, it seems like this could soon be a fundamental play. This stock is Greenergy Holdings of Tony Chu. Let us know if you got that blind item. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. And that is it for Market Edge. I am Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks.
When you think about the millennials and the young physicians,